brought to you by
Eaton Detroit Spring, proudly made in the USA.
Classic Car or Muscle Car, we want to show you how to restore your automobile and save yourself some money in the process. Sometimes we consult the pros, sometimes we mess up. But just remember, it's never a problem, it's always a project.
Right now on Auto Restomod, Jeff and Vinny tear into the radiator core support and fender apron to make room for new parts.
There! Fixed it.
Honey, what are you doing out there?
Waiting on the next Super Blowout 3-day only mega sale.
You don't need a sale. You need NPD.
NPD's everyday prices are competitive with most sales, and orders arrive fast from our four strategically located superstores. National Parts Depot has quality parts for Mustang, Camaro, Chevelle, GTO, Firebird, Ford, and Chevy truck. For your free catalog, go online or call toll-free.
Working beats waiting.
Raining out, man. This thing's great for keeping the rain off you.
That's not what it's for. That's your battery tray.
That's an apron.
Yes, right. That is your apron.
I'm ready to cook.
No, not that kind of apron. It's a battery tray apron.
Huh. Well, that doesn't look right at all.
You probably ought to let the guy who knows how that goes in there kind of, you know, do the install thing.
Well, that looks a little
there
better.
You go. Are you getting it? Should we go tell the people about what we're doing this week and the parts that we have rather than you standing there mucking about? Probably. We got a lot to do. It's going to be a very long day.
Yeah, I can see that.
All right, man, let's get busy.
Ooh, pretty new parts.
Shiny sheet metal. Well, not shiny. It's actually got an E-code
subdued.
On it. It's a subdued. This is the stuff from National Parts Depot. We got a battery tray apron in from them, and we got a radiator core support to replace the crapped out sheet metal on your car. Couple little things on the radiator core support that I want to talk about. Now, there should be a captive nut right here. I'm going to go ahead and just basically get one of these from AMK. Now, on the battery tray apron, we're going to talk about this for just a second because there is something that I want to do on this car that's a little different than what the factory did. Now, the factory used a different kind of battery tray. The battery tray I've got right here is one that we picked up from the guys at National Parts Depot as well. Now, this battery tray, you'll notice, has the side cleats on it for an overhead mount. I like this a ton better than using the side cleat because it's getting harder and harder to find batteries that actually mount with a cleat like that. You can find them, but it's nice to be able to just get any kind of battery you may want. This allows you to use a top cover on it and hold it in place over the top of it, which is a little safer as well.
Especially when you can hook to the battery drain.
Yeah, not
instead of the radiator
hole in the
support.
Core support.
Like, oh, maybe that's what they left that for. That's optional in case you want to hook your battery support there.
No, because I pulled out the stone guard and put it on there, and that's exactly where the hole for the stone guard is for the mounting on it. So
that's not what it's for. So, you know, it's a Restomod.
All right, well, what I'm... I'm going to get over there and start getting busy on some of the things we need to do. So, let's rock and roll. Okay, so whenever you're starting to work on something like this, you might want to think that you're going to go in and just rip everything off the front end and tear into it and just start making a mess. Don't do that. What I want you to really do is to go in and start taking measurements. As soon as you get all the front sheet metal off the car and your radiator and condenser or whatever else may be on the front of the apron area here off, what you're going to want to start doing is taking measurements. Now, I've already gone in and done some of the measuring off camera to kind of get all this stuff taken care of because I just basically want to talk to you about measuring what you have. Now, on this car, what I do is I'm going to go to the very back here. I'm going to put my tape measure in there, run it up to the front, and I know that from that point on the back of the car to the front of the apron here, I am at 40 inches. You'll note that I also went in on this and marked my position back here to know which one I'm in case for whatever reason I am a couple of days out from being able to finish this thing. In other words, I want to make sure that I have this mark known. So I put a mark in purple back here with my paint pen. And I use paint pens for this. You can use China markers, whatever. If you're going to be trying to keep some of this metal, probably don't want to do this. But as you can see on this car, that's It's really not an issue because we're going to repaint everything anyway, so I'm not that worried about putting these in. But the 40 measure from front to rear, because we are replacing our apron, is not the only measure that we need. We'll also need to go across the front of the radiator core support and get a measurement there. And we're at 46 7/8, which I've marked on the core support right here. Now, I'll also want to go to the other side of the car and do the same measurement from the same location. Back here where the measurement is on the passenger side, I want to do a measure to the front. And lo and behold, we're at 40 inches over here as well. So we know that we're even across the front of the car from back to front and back to front. You want to make sure you know that before you get working on this thing. If you take a measure and you're a half inch out on one side or the other, you want to do an all stop because you've got another problem somewhere else in the car, most likely in a frame rail damage or something like that, especially if you start taking measurements down on the bottom and you have the same issues. So you want to make sure you take those kind of measurements when you're doing this. Another thing I like to do is I like to take a measurement across the top of the engine bay here so that we know what we've got. And I try to get it up as close as I can to that. And on this particular car, measuring across from where the two bolts are that hold the bumper in, we are at 39 7/8. So I'm going to write that information on my old core support. So I put 39 7/8 at brace. And then what I also want to do is I want to take a measurement from the very back here up to either the very front of the core support or the very back of the core support. Your better measurement would be up here at the front because that is going to be where you want that thing to sit at center. You want the center of it in about the same place. So this is 40 3/8. So it looks like this is bellying out a little bit, and that may be some core support damage because this should be pretty flat, but I can see a little bit of a belly on this. So we may just use this as an ish measurement. So I'm gonna go ahead and get these measurements put on here. And then I'm going to talk to you a little bit about some of the stuff on the front because of how we're doing the apron on this car. Okay, now what I'm going to talk about is basically the front of the core support, because we're doing things a little different than we would if we were just going to go ahead and replace the apron and cross piece on here. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to come in here and I'm going to grab my stool and my straight edge. And what I want to do is, I've already done this, but I want to take a measure from the top of this line. So basically I want to put this in here straight, and I want to make a mark across here and down, and then I want to go in and measure that. And now I know already that this one, the apron from that position, 16 5/8 inches long. So from here to this line on this line here is 16 5/8. That's going to become really important when we start going in and aligning these two pieces to get them to set in the spot that they were in before. We want to make sure that this is level. Now, another thing I think you ought to probably do when you're doing these measures is to also take a measure off of the floor to the bottom of the rail here. Now the measure here on this one is 12 1/4, and on the other side I'm at 12 1/16. I will say this about springs. Whenever you're doing a car, there's no way that they can set the springs up for everything to be exactly level and flat. You're probably going to have some variances, and some of these variances can actually be in the construction of the car. You may have a change in the frame rails. When the car was being built back in 1965, because it was being spot welded by a bunch of guys named Bob in a knock-up shop at Ford, there is absolutely no telling what you're gonna have. You can have as much as 1/8 inch of difference between side to side on the car, and even in panel fitment from what Ford's numbers tell you they should be. Now, one thing I wanna talk about too next is things you may want to watch out for if you're having to go in and replace that driver's apron as well. This apron is going to be problematic from one standpoint, and that's because on the early 65 to 67 Mustangs, your VIN number for the car is posted right here. There's actually a cutout in the fender so you can see it. So if you go in and you actually replace this apron, you'll lose your VIN number, and then you get in trouble with the cops if you ever get pulled over and they start giving you any kind of grief. So what you'll want to try to do, at least in my opinion, if your upper portion is okay, you will want to go in and make a cut probably somewhere down in here and along this line here, and keep this upper section in position or reuse it so that you can keep this. Another way to do that, if you don't want to do this, if this is not in good shape, and this is all wrinkled up in here, is you can actually go in and cut this out. Is it legal? Probably not. So am I telling you you should do this? No, you shouldn't. So that's the other thing that you can do on this. This is a very important piece on your car. Don't misplace this if you do cut it out. If you do it right and do it nicely. Actually go in and dress the underside of it as well, because if you don't, it's going to look like someone's been in there, and then they're going to start giving you even more grief. So you need to make this look really good. If you don't feel comfortable doing it, by all means, take this to a shop and have them weld it in there for you. This happens a lot more than you might suspect. Whatever you do, don't put one VIN from another car on another car, because there are other places on here that the police can check to know where the VIN number is at, and then you can get in even more trouble.
All right, so right now what we want to do is go ahead and clean up where the battery apron meets the frame rail. You never know what kind of spot weld you're going to run into there, and they're always really just cluttered with dirt and junk. So I'm going to hit it with a scraper first to get some of the bigger stuff off, and then I'm going to go ahead and hit it with a wire brush just to clean it up so we can see where the spot welds are. So now that we've cleaned that up on the outside, we're going to have to do the same thing on the inside where the fender apron meets the radiator core support. So here we go.
Okay, folks, now I want to talk a little bit about safety before I start doing any kind of work on this car. One of the things I want you to make sure you do is you put some hearing protection in when you're doing any of this cutting, especially if you're going to be going in and using any kind of grinders or air hammers or cutters like I'm going to be doing here. You also want to wear your eye protection. I know, as sexy as this is, everyone will want these to go to the beach in, but you need them because you're going to be getting debris flying everywhere. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take and cut this section off here and make a cut down through here so they don't have to deal with trying to cut all these spot welds off that are, since this is all going away, we don't need. So we'll go and get busy cutting. I don't know if you could see that, but whenever I pushed this in, we had a little bit of inside collapse. Now that kind of tells you that, the apron moved in just a little. And I don't think that's really an issue at this point, because we're going to be able to pull that back out. But we do have that apron where it dropped in. Something to keep in mind of when I'm working on this. I'm going to make this final cut down here, then we're going to start going in and finishing up our spot welder. All right, now what I want to do is I want to start making my spot weld cuts. Now, what I was going to say is this. Because of this right here, that's why that outside 46-inch measure is important. I don't think that's really collapsing the front end. We have the frame rail all the way around the base here. We still have our supports for the struts and all that in place. I don't think we're going to have a problem. We've also got our measurements from the floor. So we know how all deep all this stuff needs to be, where all our measurements are at, because in a minute, all of this section will be gone. We're going to need to go in and do some cleanup and look for our spot welds. So get busy on that. All right, now what I'm going to do here is I have got spot welds all over the place, but I wanted to just give you a heads up on some of the easier ones for me to show. We have to cut the spot welds both off of the radiator core support on this particular car, and then we also have to cut the spot welds off on the actual core support that we got from National Parts Depot. So what we're going to do now is we're going to go in and we're actually going to just show you how to cut these out. Now there's a couple of different tools you can use for this. One of them is just a plain old standard drill bit. You can use a drill bit to cut these out, and that's probably not a bad idea. Even if I cut all the way through this, because I'm going to come back in and weld from the underside so that we don't have a hole up here that we have to fill with filler, it'll be okay if I drill straight through. The other thing that you can do if you're trying to maintain your metal is to use one of these spot weld cutters that you can get from the tool supply places. National Parts Depot also carries these cutters as well. You can get one of these, and there's two different sizes for them. You can use these to center punch and cut your welds. The one thing I will say is on a weld like this one right here, a drill is probably going to be your best bet because you've got a really large shoulder on the outside top of the actual weld point. What happened is when they hit this thing with the welder, which it's like a clamp, it went in here and he did this and he was at this angle rather than being very straight to it. Same thing with this one. This one was welded at a mild angle. So this kind of cutter is going to have a harder time with this kind of weld. If it's very straight and flat, shouldn't be an issue. And on these, I'm just going to use a drill bit because, quite frankly, it's just a lot easier. One thing you want to do is you want to go in and center punch these if you can with a punch like this. And then what you want to do is you want to put a guide point in there so that your drill bit doesn't walk around on you. And you're going to want to do that to every one of these on the car. Now I'm going to change out my drill bit to the larger size so we can cut these out. And I'm going to show you a little tip on how to do that. I'm going to go in and center set this. Now you hear the pitch change in that. That tells me that it's fixing to bust all the way through. And you're going to kind of want to be in mind of that. And believe me, after you do about 35 of these, you'll start to know what that sounds like on your car. I'm going to go in and start getting the rest of these cut up, and then I'm going to show you what you kind of need to do to try to separate this and making sure that the sacrificial panel, which is this one, and not your main panel, which is this one, the one you're keeping, gets bent and beat up and torn up when you're taking it off. You don't want to hurt this one. If you're going to hurt anything, you want to hurt this one. Got that done? Now I'm going to grab myself a little screwdriver and start prying around on these and see if I've got the welds completely cut. I suspect on these two, probably not. Okay, now I found three more spot welds, and this is what you can run into when you're doing this kind of stuff. I was going to go ahead and start talking about hammering this out and removing this and rolling this section up, but there's actually on a 65 and 66 Mustang, this fender lip or the apron lip rolls this way on the backside. You really can't see it. And they take a spot weld and put one here, and whoever it was really industrious because he put one here, one here, one here, and heck, there may be five or six more that I don't see yet, but there's at least three right here. So we're gonna have to go in, cut those out, and then I can start talking about hammering things out in theory. Oh, and that's another thing. Whenever you're working on this kind of stuff, if you can have two drill motors at hand so that all you have to do is to pick one up to do your guide holes with and have your other drill motor to do the other work with, better for you because you're not having to go in and change drill bits out every couple of seconds in order to do something like what we're having to do right here. Because I have to tell you, you're going to be doing this more than just this once. There's probably going to be places where it doesn't look like there's a spot weld there at all, but there is. Could I do this with an air hammer? Yeah, I probably could, but I'm going to use a hand chisel and a really big mallet, tightening up on the mallet a little bit in order to get this stuff to pull out. It's a fairly delicate spot to be working because we don't want to wreck that apron. And this is a place where you can actually go in and start finding other spot welds that you may have missed. Now probably what I'm going to do is I'm going to take my cutoff wheel and I'm going to kiss that corner right there just so I can get that out of it. And what I'm trying to do now is I want to just try to go up underneath here and see what I've got. I need to cut that section out real quickly. There we go. And what I want to try to do is actually roll this up and not damage that undermetal. I can tell you right now that you're probably going to have to do a little bit of body work on your undermetal just to make sure that it's okay. Now you can see this one here has let loose. This one has let loose. This one, not so much. I'm going to probably want to get a pair of pliers and start rolling this up and see if I can roll it off and find where my attaching point is up underneath here. I'll get my pliers and I'm going to go in and start rolling this out and seeing what I got. We're pretty loose here now. The only ones that are still holding on are these three front, I think. So we're gonna have to get those undone somehow. All right, we've chiseled this out. I'm going to roll this back over on itself a little bit on the core support side so that I can reveal this and kind of see what I need to do bodywork wise in order to get this to clean up and be ready to go for us to start doing our welding when we're ready to do our welding. Got a little bit of a warble here because of that cut that we had to make, and this has kind of got a rise to it and a little bit of rise here, so we'll go in and hammer and dolly this in a second. One thing I want to do though is I'm not sure if I've got a spot weld right here, so I'm going to take my chisel and my hammer and just run it down to where I know the first spot weld is, and it looks like there's probably one, not one, until, there we go, I popped it. Sometimes you can pop them off like that, but most of the time you can't. Our first real spot weld is right here, so now I know that that's where that is and I'm ready to go on it. I'm going to take, put aside my huge hammer and bring out my dolly and my other hammer for this, and this is basically just a standard bodyworking hammer, and I'm not even sure what this dolly is called. It's one I've had in my kit for a good while. It's a dolly, and you can get heel dollies, you can get hammers and everything in a lot of the tool companies. So what I'm going to do now is I'm just going to put this on the back side here, and I'm gonna go in and flatten this out so that it's a nice flat surface for us to work to whenever we start putting everything back together. Because we did get some roll up on this one as well when we took it apart. You have to be careful and look at your panels, because on this one, it's probably a little hard to see, but this is flat and then it kicks up and moves back to the main part of the plate on the apron here. So you don't want to start going in and flattening all this out and just kind of going in pell-mell and working it. You want to go in and make sure that all this stuff that needs to be flat is flat. We're looking pretty good. I got a couple more places I want to go in and work. But that's what we're doing right now. We're getting all this back into a condition so that we can put the apron on here. Now I get to move on to the 52,484 other spot welds on this thing. I've got a little tip for you on that. I'm going to show you on the battery tray apron side. All right, now I've got my radiator core support cut away on this side, and I've got all my spot welds removed on this side. So basically what I want to do now is go in and make a cut across the bottom of the radiator core support to remove this piece so we can actually get to the spot welds in the bottom of this plate a little bit easier. It just makes it a little bit nicer when you're trying to go in and get these down on this end, because you'll have more exposure and be able to move your tools around a little bit better in order to get into that spot. So I'm gonna cut this out, and then we'll go ahead and move on to the next problem, which is going to be getting those out. Hey Vinny, can you hold that for me? Just hold this plate in place. There we go. Take her away, Vinny. Now, we got a nice open area that we can work in order to get to these spot welds on the front. And then we got to go in and attack that apron.
All right, so as you can see before me, we have the old and the new. And we've already made all the little guide points so we can cut these two pieces apart. I say cut, but we're going to use the drill just like we've shown you over and over again. One other important piece is there, we've got two holes here on the old unit that were used for passing air conditioning hoses through, and you want to duplicate those before you install the new piece on the car. So what we're going to show you later on is we're going to cut this piece off of the old one, and we're going to use that as a template so we can mark our holes for the new radiator core support and still be able to run our air conditioning when we're all done.
Okay, now a hot tip that I can give you when you're doing this kind of stuff and you're wanting to find your spot welds in the easiest way possible would be to go in and use a flashlight like I'm fixing to do here. And you can shine your flashlight across the welds like I'm showing you now, and it picks up your spot welds a lot easier. You can actually see where they're at, and then you can use an auto punch to mark them like I've been doing. Now there's one other thing I wanted to talk about real quick on these core support setups. On the early cars, if it's got an original core support, you can see a blob weld here, and you got another blob weld here. Now this blob weld was set in here to hold in the radiator core support to the lower brace. So you're going to have to go in and probably use a grinder or something to cut these blob welds out here and here, and probably down on the other end as well. There's one or two down there usually. And that'll clear those out so you can go in and finish working on this. One other piece of information that I wanted to go into, and that's this. In this corner right here, there is a fold back. This actually folds into the backside of the frame rail over here. So I'm not so sure if they did a spot weld set in there or not. If they did, that's going to be a bit of a nightmare, and we'll probably attack that with our air chisel after we get this stuff out and fold it out of the way. Sometimes you just need to employ the power tools, and what we've got here is a pneumatic air hammer with a chisel bit on it that has a nick out of the center of it, and I go in and sharpen these ends up pretty flat so I can go in and actually bite in underneath those spot welds and pop them up. In a place like this where we're at right now, quite honestly, you're not going to do this with a hammer and a hand chisel unless you have the engine out of the engine bay. Then that becomes a possibility for you. So what you'll want is one of these air hammers, and you're just going to go in and just worry that stuff out of the hole. You'll hear the air hammer change pitch. Usually that means that it's biting through. Now those two end cap pieces are still holding everything in place. I'm going to have to figure out a way to cut those out because I can't really get my grinder down in there. Let me just try to use this. Put my gloves on here because I'm on the rusty side now. Now these pieces originally were galvanized, so they used to be where they wouldn't rust out that bad, but after a while, even the galvanizing doesn't do you a whole lot of good. One little tab hanging on there. And we're gonna have to go in and cut this off the backside too. There we go. One inside piece cut out. Now what I'm gonna do is, I didn't throw that away. What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna actually go in now and clean all this up, get all the little errant schmutz out of here. And we'll probably put some POR-15 or something, some kind of rust inhibitors inside of this again after we've done some cleanup work on it. And I'm going to pound all these flanges flat, make them look nice again. It's a driver, I know, but we kind of want to make this look a little bit better. But one of the other things I'm going to do is after I get all this flattened out with my grinder, I'm going to go in and lay the new panel in here after we cut the new one off of the lower piece here and test fit it, make sure it's going to go into place like it's supposed to with all the measurements that we're supposed to be retraining. So that's the next thing, but we'll cover all of that next week. Okay, so I've got that out. The next thing now is to go to my apron. We'll get on that here in just a minute. There! I fixed it. Right, I did the down and dirty on this one. Basically, you can see by my lovely chewed edge on the back side of this that we went a little far. I wanted to do it this way just to kind of show you that you can down and dirty this if you have a good air hammer. So basically I would use a chisel bit like this on just about any of this, but you have to remember this is only going to work when you have a thicker metal like what we got here on the shock tower. If it wasn't a thick metal like here and down on the lower rail, you would not be able to use this method to do it because it's going to just end up boogering up the rest of the metal too bad for it to work. So basically, that's done for now. And we're going to go in next week and show you how to put all this stuff back together. I'm going to go try to find Vinny because he's supposed to be cutting apart the radiator core support on the new one. There's no telling. A lot of work.
Oh, wow. You already got the battery apron out.
Oh, yeah. We ran through all that stuff.
I'm kind of liking that peeled metal roadster kind of look we've got going on here.
You need to stop with the roadster thing.
I like it, man.
You need to stop with the roadster.
I like the open wheel look.
You need to stop with the roadster.
Pay a lot of money for those tires. I want to show them off.
You need to stop with the roadster thing. We've got to get this all back together because I really, basically, we need to get this horse back to being a drivable car. Now, I know we haven't done the seat fans yet. That's coming soon. As soon as those are released, we'll get those in here. They're still working on the little kinks they wanted to get fixed on them. As soon as those get in, bada bing, bada boom, you got seat pans and it's drivable again.
Mustang Roadster.
Except the clutch. All right, folks, that's our show for this week. We're going to be coming back next week with a finalizing on this, showing you how to get the sheet metal lined up and everything in position so that it's back where it was originally, only with new sheet metal and looking a lot better than it did before. So do us a favor and come back and watch us next time on AutoRestoMod. Have a great week. No.
Put the hood down.
No. Go do something else because you're You're tripping me out.
I'm gonna go draw it up.
Mike Chang!